Warning, the following video contains spoilers for the first half of Season 2 of My Hero Academia. If you haven't watched the My Hero Academia Sports Festival arc, please go watch it and then come back to this video. My Hero Academia Season 2 released on April 1st of 2017, which is pretty crazy to release something that had as much anticipation as My Hero Season 2 on April Fool's Day of all days. Anyways, I'm going to be going over the first 13 episodes of Season 2, aka the Sports Festival arc. This arc has always remained my favorite arc of the show so far, but let's see how well it holds up 5 years after debuting. Before we get into that, however, I just wanted to thank you all for how much support you showed on the review video for the first season, which if you haven't watched yet, I'll leave a card in the top right of the screen, so that way you can go check it out. With that being said, my name is JMONEY, and let's get ready to go beyond Plus Ultra style into the My Hero Academia Sports Festival arc. So the first episode of Season 2 is just a recap of Season 1. So that's why they released it on April Fool's Day. Anyways, let's skip on ahead to the next episode where the season actually starts. The first half of episode 14 is dedicated to pro heroes trying to think on where to look to find Shigaraki and Kurogiri. Then we're back at Class 1A as they're told about the upcoming UA Sports Festival, and they're getting excited about being able to show out in front of an audience. Then Uraraka channels her inner Bakugo, saying she's more than ready for it. Or what Mineta calls it.
Jesus Christ, man.
Back to Uraraka, she tells Midori and Ida that she wants to become a hero so that way she can get money to help support her family. Aw, that's sweet.
Oh God, oh my, what are you doing here?
Lunch. You wanna eat with me?
Really not trying to hide the relationship between you and Deku, are you? Anyways, Midoriya talks to All Might saying that in the USJ, when he didn't break his arm that one time he used One For All, it felt different since he was using it on an actual person. So you're telling me that you're fine with smashing robots and leveling buildings with it full force, but you're not gonna use that full force on a villain threatening your life?
That makes sense to me.
Oh, you dimbulb! Take back your wallet and I'll rip your arms!
Either way, after that, a big crowd of students are gathered outside of Class 1A to scout the competition for the festival. Bakugo approaches them, calling them extras. Which, I mean, he's not wrong! Then, new character Satoshi Shinso and Tetsu.
I'm not kidding, that's his actual name.
Confront Bakugo and tell him off. But Mr. Boom has better things to do. He has some bottles to go kick. Then after a quick training montage, it's time for the festival to begin. But first, Todoroki approaches Midori to tell him that not only is he stronger than Deku, but that'll beat him in the festival. Going all in on a declaration of war, aren't you, Todoroki? So before we get into the sports festival, let's dive in on what the rules are for it. First, all those students are separated by class years. Then the Hero Course, Support Course, Business Course, and General Studies Course students go through some preliminary trials to determine a bracket where they compete in one-on-one battles until the winner is decided. Which, overall, there are 11 classes in terms of first-year students in participation. Now let's begin the introduction ceremony with
Mommy.
I mean Midnight! As she brings up Bakugo as the first year rep to give the student pledge. Bakugo goes up on stage in front of everyone with no fear, saying,
I just wanna say, I'm gonna win.
Anyways, it's time for the first competition, an obstacle course race. All the students in the 11 classes basically have to run around the outside perimeter of the stadium, avoiding obstacles and trying to be the first one back inside the stadium. And as long as they don't leave the course, they have free reign to do whatever they want. So if you want to kill Midoriya, now's your chance, Bakugo. It's like a get out of jail free card straight from Midnight. As we begin, everyone is trapped inside the doorway, but a bunch of Class 1A gets off to a hot start with Todoroki taking an early lead after freezing everyone and skating his way ahead. But wait, Mineta's about to take the lead! Never mind. And the robots from the entrance exam are back. Even the giant zero-point robots. Todoroki freezes them and quickly increases his lead, because everyone is still dealing with other robots, including Midoriya as he wonders what to do to deal with them. Bakugo, Sero, and Tokuyami soar above and over the robots and are trying to catch Todoroki as the rest of Class 1A destroys most of the robots. Even Midoriya, as he takes a fallen piece of a robot as a shield slash weapon for possible use later. All the robots are now defeated and everyone is back on track in the race as they approach the next obstacle, where they have to reach a cliff on the other side and maneuver from rock to rock and try not to fall into the gorge below. Asui leaps forward and latches onto a rope and makes her way over. Then support horse student Mei Hatsume shows off her gadgets as she uses them to take advantage of the situation and launches herself halfway across. And Todoroki and Bakugo cross the gorge first and make their way over to the third and final obstacle, a giant minefield. Holy crap, if you want to kill some teenagers, all you had to do was say that.
You had me at killing teenagers.
Bakugo takes the lead and battles with Todoroki to try and keep that lead. Midoriya realizes that he's extremely far behind everyone, so Midoriya says,
yeah, this is big brain time.
And digs up and gathers a bunch of mines together in one spot and slams his robot shield on it, making a massive explosion and sending Deku all the way to the front to become the new leader. Bakugo and Todoroki then charge in hot pursuit of Midoriya, but he must have been watching Rick and Morty between seasons because he slams his shield down on more mines to make his lead even greater. Deku, Bakugo, and Todoroki are now in a three-way battle to enter the stadium first. And the winner of the race is Midoriya! And he didn't have to use one for all at all, which honestly makes his victory even more impressive. Then after a quick look at the standings after the race, it's quickly time to get ready for the second game, the Cavalry Battle, where only the top 42 students during the race are allowed to participate. The rules for the Cavalry Battle is a team-based event where students group up in teams of 2 to 4 people, and each player is assigned a point value based on their placement in the race, and their team value will be everyone's placement score combined and placed on a headband. Those headbands must be worn from the neck up. Only the top 16 students could qualify, and you're allowed to keep competing until time is up. And for placing first in the race, our favorite dude who didn't think this through will be worth 10 million points, which means everyone will be gunning for his team during the battle. Uh-oh, I think Deku's having a heart attack again. With 15 minutes to build his team, our favorite whack with a heart attack needs to start strategizing and building his team. We see some of the people who end up grouping together, such as Bakugo and Kirishima pairing together, and Mineta and Shoji teaming up. Uraraka and Midoriya agree to team up and approach Ida to try to team up with him as well. But Ida declines, saying that he already agreed to be a part of Todoroki's team. Plus, now Ida wants to challenge Midoriya as well to try to push himself forward. Why is everyone suddenly challenging Midoriya? Just because you want a race? Hatsume pops up to try to team up with Midoriya and Uraraka, to which they agree. And Deku gets another teammate, but we don't immediately see who it is till later. Now it's time for the cavalry battle to begin, and the teammate Midoriya got was Tokoyami, as they're ready to protect the 10 million point headband. Todoroki's team consists of himself, Ida, Kaminari, and Yayurozu, and Bakugo's team contains himself, Kirishima, Mina, and Sarah. The battle begins and everyone immediately pursues Midoriya's team, and he tries to do the Joseph Joestar special and running away, but his team is sinking into the ground, so Midoriya uses the jetpack Hatsume gave him to launch into the sky. They land and continue running away from everyone else. Things are getting hectic, and Deku's team is stuck again while trying to run. This time, Mineta put one of his balls underneath a boot for Uraraka to step on.
I bet he really loves that.
Midoriya uses the jetpack again, but one of the hover boots gets destroyed because of how sticky Mineta's ball was.
Gross.
Bakugo soars into the sky to try to take his headband, but Tokoyami blocked his attack with Dark Shadow, and Sarah pulls back Bakugo. Excluding Midoriya and Todoroki's groups, however, Class 1A's groups aren't doing so hot, though, with the other class groups taking headbands left and right, including Bakugo's headband. Bakugo now has a change of plans in his attack to take down Class 1B. And finally, Midoriya's group goes head-to-head with Todoroki's group, as they are now face-to-face and about to battle. Everyone quickly surrounds the teams, and Todoroki's team uses a coordinated assault, including Kaminari shocking everyone and Todoroki freezing the other teams after being immobilized. Todoroki and his team keep on the attack as Tokoyami is worried about Kaminari's quirk as Dark Shadow is having a moral dilemma.
Nothing.
Back to Bakugo, he's facing off against Class 1B's Naito Monoma and his group. Monoma's quirk is that he can copy other people's quirks, but only for 5 minutes and only one quirk at a time. Then Bakugo gets stopped by another Class 1B team as they escape.
Ida then decides to shift into maximum overdrive,
and Todoroki is able to take the 10 million point headband. But Midoriya charges back to try and take it back. Bakugo charges in to try and take Monoma's headbands and succeeds, and now his team moves into third place. But he's not done yet, and charges forward with his team and takes the last of Monoma's headbands. Midoriya uses one for all, and again, his arm doesn't break, pushing Todoroki to the side, and Deku grabs a random headband. But he grabs a headband worth only 70 points, and there's barely any time left. So in the final showdown, everything goes awry, and both Bakugo and Midoriya charge towards Todoroki to try and get as many points as they can. But time expires. Todoroki's team placed first, Bakugo's team placed second, and Itoshi Shinso's group places third out of nowhere. But Midoriya believes that he didn't make it to the next round. But Tokoyami had Dark Shadow take a headband from Todoroki worth 615 points, giving Midoriya just enough points to finish in the top four.
Is it just me or am I experiencing deja vu?
Midoriya then channels One For All into his eyes and cries so hard about making it to the next round, he breaks the ground beneath him. That's a first if I've ever seen one. After the cavalry battle is over, Todoroki pulls Deku aside to ask him a question, asking if Midoriya is All Might's secret love child, to which Izuku obviously denies it.
You know, cause he's not. Unless...
Todoroki then explains to him that his father had never married his mom and made Shoto with the sole purpose of him beating All Might someday, which is...
whew, some hard stuff.
Todoroki despises his father so much because his mom called the left side of Shoto unbearable and poured boiling hot water on his face.
Somebody please get this guy some therapy. One like equals one therapy session for Todoroki.
Everyone in the top 16 are about to draw to see who they match up with in the one-on-one battles. But before that, Ojiro all of a sudden decides to drop out of the competition. The reason why Ojiro is dropping out is because he suspects he was used like a puppet with Shinso's quirk, and his pride won't let him continue. Nirengeki Shota from Class 1B, who was also in Shinso's group, also decides to withdraw for the same reason. Guys, just take the spots of the tournament. This is the best your character's ever gonna get. Trust me. As a result, and after Itsuka Kendo's group, who placed 5th, decides to drop out of replacing Ojiro and Shota because their group was frozen for most of the battle, Tetsu and Ibaru Shiozaki from the 6th place team will replace them in the finals. And the matchups for the first round are as follows. Tetsu versus Kirishima, Tokoyami versus Yaoyorozu, Mina versus Aoyama, Todoroki versus Sero, Bakugo versus Uraraka, Ida versus Hatsume, Kaminari versus Shiozaki, and Midoriya versus Shinso. As Deku looks at the matchups and realizes he can face Todoroki in the second round, he's approached by Shinso, who asks Midoriya if he's excited for the match. Before he can reply though, Ojiro covers up Deku's mouth and warns him to not say any words to Shinso. Easy rules, Deku, just keep your mouth shut and you'll be good. Now it's time to get ready for the first match, Midoriya versus Shinso. Also, for just a second, can we talk about how amazing these visual shots are of Midoriya and Shinso before the battle starts? One thing I love about the Sports Festival arc is that they bring constant stunning visuals in the intros and battles. Shinso then channels his inner Frieza.
That monkey was going on about his pride earlier, but I just think he's an idiot for throwing away his chance like that.
Is that racist or something?
This gets under Midoriya's skin, however, and you remember that advice Ojiro gave him earlier? Yeah, Deku's brain is back to normal and back to not listening to advice people give him. This allows Shinso to use his brainwashing quirk to make our favorite pup who can't shut up freeze in his tracks. And those soulless eyes from the first video are back again. Shinso tells our favorite boy who's plain and lacking a brain to turn around and walk out of the ring, which he follows and starts his way walking out. And as he approaches the out-of-bounds line of the arena, Midoriya sees a vision of a bunch of shadow demons looking for beans, which scares Midoriya so bad that he instinctively uses One For All in his fingers just before he steps out of bounds to break the brainwashing spell. After breaking the hold, Midoriya runs towards Shinso and starts pushing him towards the out-of-bounds line. Shinso fights out, and as he goes for an attack, Midoriya counters into his special judo throw, and Shinso ends up out of bounds, meaning Midoriya moves on to the second match. I honestly really love this match. It's because it's something different from the other fights we've had so far in My Hero. It didn't need to have high-paced actions like earlier fights in order to draw the viewer in with suspense. After the match, when Midoriya talks to All Might about the vision he saw within the match, it turns out that there are former users of One For All, All Might included. This will come more into play in later seasons, so just keep that in mind for right now. Now it's time for the second match to start, Todoroki versus Sero. And in this match,
Sero he dies!
Todoroki freezes Sero, winning quickly with ease. At least he said sorry in advance. The third match is about to start with Kaminari versus Shiozaki. As soon as the match starts, Kaminari asks Shiozaki if she'd like to go out after the match, saying that he'd be there to console her after she loses. Hey Kaminari, use Thunderbolt! Shiozaki uses Protect, however, and then uses Vine Whip quickly after to immobilize Kaminari, winning the match as quickly as it started. Hey, I think you spoke a little too soon about winning there, Kaminari. Now the next fight is about to start, and it's Ida versus Hatsume. Before the match, Ida decides to put on a gadget that Hatsume made. Ida, correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think it's a good idea to use stuff your opponent made to use against themselves. Use your brain, man. You have glasses, after all. Hatsume proves that theory immediately, as she uses most of the fight to just promote her gadgets and use Ida as a guinea pig. Then, as soon as Hatsume has Ida completely embarrassed and after showing off all her stuff, Hatsume walks out of the ring, meaning that Ida moves on to the second round. Then we move on to the match between Mina and Aoyama. Aoyama starts out immediately using his laser to try and defeat Mina quickly, but she dodges for long enough so Aoyama's belly hurts, and Mina wins soon after with her burning Aoyama's belt and then hitting him with a massive uppercut. Moving on to the fight between Yayurozu and Tokoyami, Tokoyami relentlessly attacks Yayurozu with Dark Shadow, not giving her any time to make anything with her quirk, and she quickly ends up out of bounds, meaning Tokoyami moves on. And just like that, we only have two matches remaining in the first round. So let's get into it with Kirishima versus Tetsu Tetsu. This one is definitely the most interesting, since they not only have similar quirks, but also similar personalities. Sadly, most of this match takes place off-screen while Deku and Ida try to help Uraraka with their nerves of going up against Bakugo. Our favorite stalker, who has something to offer, offers up his notes that he has on Bakugo for Uraraka to use, but she rejects the notes, saying that she wants to take on Bakugo on her own without any assistance. Back to the fight, Kirishima and Tetsu Tetsu knock each other out, meaning it ends in a draw, and their outcome will be determined later on with something else. Now on to the final battle of the first round between Bakugo
versus the one I'm personally rooting for, also from Class 1A, Okshaka Uraraka!
What do you mean by that?
Bakugo tells Uraraka that he won't hold back against her. Uraraka then starts out charging towards him, but Bakugo blasts her, but Uraraka keeps on the attacks and distracts Bakugo with her jacket and goes to try and make him float with her quirk. But Bakugo is quick enough to react and blast her back. Uraraka keeps charging, but Bakugo keeps her at bay with his explosions. Uraraka wanted this to happen, however, because she made multiple parts of the arena that got sent from Bakugo's explosion float, and she releases them to land on him and charges toward Bakugo, but he uses his quirk to not only send Uraraka flying back, but destroying the rocks above as well. Bakugo runs towards Uraraka to try and finish off, but she faints before either student could do anything else, meaning Bakugo moves on to the next round. And now, Kirishima and Tetsu Tetsu will have an arm wrestling contest to decide who the person will move on will be, which Kirishima wins! And now it's on to the second round, and the first match is Midoriya versus Todoroki. The match that this entire arc has been building up to, and in my opinion, the best fight of not only a sports festival arc, but in season 2 as a whole. Todoroki tries to go for another quick victory, but Midoriya uses a one-for-all charge finger flick to ricochet the ice off, breaking one of his fingers though. Todoroki goes for the same maneuver, but again, Deku flicks the ice away, breaking another one of his fingers and playing a more defensive strategy. Todoroki goes in for a third time, and again, Midoriya blasts the ice away. Todoroki attacks again, and Midoriya uses the last finger, excluding his thumb, on his right hand. Todoroki manages to trap Midoriya's foot in ice, however, but he uses his quirk in his left arm to free himself. But this limits what Deku can do, since this breaks his left arm. Although he notices that Todoroki's right side is starting to freeze up more, since he's using too much of his ice powers. Todoroki assumes that Midoriya can't defend anymore since all of his fingers are pretty much broken, and goes in for what he believes to be the final blow. But her favorite dummy used Bones Went Funny, blasts the ice away after using a finger he'd already broken. Does that mean that his finger is double broken now, or what? Midoriya tells Todoroki that he wants him to come at him with everything that he has, and that he shouldn't hold back. Todoroki continues to deny using his fire powers because of how he despises his father and charges forward on the attack. But Midoriya channels one for all and punches Todoroki back. But the drawback is that he broke his thumb and double broke the other four fingers on his right hand. At least he isn't fighting with two broken arms though. Todoroki goes in for another ice attack, but this time Midoriya uses his right hand thumb to flick one for all off his cheek to blast it away this time, and knocks Todoroki back. Then charges in and headbutts him in the stomach. As he keeps trying to get through to Todoroki to make him use all of his power, Midoriya channels the one for all into his right arm and hits Todoroki in the chest without breaking his arm. Todoroki says that he still won't use his fire, and Midoriya says that the fire Todoroki possesses is his, not Endeavor's. After hearing that, Todoroki unleashes his flames in an incredible burst. Endeavor is ecstatic that he used his flames, but Todoroki ignores him and gets ready to unleash a final attack on Midoriya. Both students charge in, but teachers decide to intervene before either student can get extremely hurt. With everything ending with an explosion so big and powerful, it put Megumin to shame. After the dust settles, however, Midoriya is sent out of bounds and unconscious, which means Todoroki moves on to the third round. Midoriya gets his injuries healed, and then is told by Recovery Girl that not only will his right arm never be the same as before, but that she won't be healing up his injuries anymore. Our favorite boy who owns broken bones now needs to find a better way to use one for all without breaking his body repeatedly. Ida quickly wins his second round match against Shiozaki after pushing her out of bounds. Tokoyami also wins quickly in his match against Mina, using Dark Shadow to push her out of bounds. Sorry to go over these other fights so quickly, but there's not really much else to say about them, because they're usually over as soon as they start. Ina tries to get a hold of his older brother, who is currently out on a mission, and his brother quickly runs into a hero killer, aka the villain of the next arc. Then we cut back to a match in progress between Bakugo and Kirishima. Man, Kirishima's really getting the short end of the stick this arc. Anyways, Bakugo is having to play defensively as Kirishima keeps on the attack and is unaffected by Bakugo's explosions. But Kirishima has been using his hardening quirk for longer than he can hold, and Bakugo is able to defeat him quickly after with a fury of explosion attacks. Now we're left with the final four, and the matchups are Ina vs. Todoroki and Bakugo vs. Tokuyami. And we quickly get into the next match between Todoroki and Ina. Todoroki quickly quarters Ina with his ice attacks and goes for a third attack, but Ina jumps up to avoid and uses his Recipro Burst, meaning he only has a short time to defeat Todoroki or else his engines and his legs will stall. Todoroki dodges a kick from Ina, but Ina quickly turns around and is able to land another kick. He then grabs Todoroki and starts running to try and throw him out of bounds. However, Todoroki blocks his engines with his ice and subdues Ida. Moving on to the finals. Just to keep bashing on the Ida family, Tenya's brother is defeated and left in a bloody mess against the hero killer villain. We cut back to Tokuyami versus Bakugo, and Bakugo is able to win after weakening Dark Shadow with his explosions, and Tokuyami is given no choice but to surrender, meaning Bakugo will take on Todoroki in the finals. Ida receives a call from his mom about his brother's condition, and I honestly really feel bad for Ida. It just isn't his day. Kurigiri approaches the hero killer villain after what he did to Ida's brother, and it's revealed that the villain's name is Stain. Kurigiri offers Stain a spot in the League of Villains, but for now we don't see his reply until the next arc, so I'm just gonna leave you on a cliffhanger for now. Now it all comes down to one final fight, between Todoroki and Bakugo, and Todoroki starts this fight just like he did the other fights, going in for an ice attack. Todoroki's the kind of person to spam the same move over and over in a fighting game. Tell me I'm wrong. Bakugo blasts away the ice with his explosions and keeps exploding his way through the ice. Both students charge towards each other, but Bakugo is able to take advantage in terms of hand-to-hand combat, and launches Todoroki, who saves himself and starts skating around on the ice like he's Frozone from The Incredibles. Bakugo charges in, but Todoroki grabs him, but when Endeavor tells him to use his flames again, Todoroki instead just throws Bakugo out of his grasp. Bakugo becomes furious that Todoroki won't use his flames.
Are we sure that Bakugo isn't Endeavor's son as well?
Bakugo charges in and Todoroki looks like he's about to give up, but words of encouragement from Midoriya give him more motivation, and Todoroki uses his flames again. But he stops the fire just as Bakugo hits him with a devastating attack. Bakugo wins after Todoroki is knocked out by the attack and knocked out of bounds. Much of Bakugo's dismay since he wanted to beat Todoroki when he was at his best. Either way you look at it, however, Katsuki Bakugo is the winner of the sports festival. At least he fulfilled his promise. Even though it wasn't to the degree of how he wanted to win it, he still won. During the award ceremony, Bakugo is so steaming angry that he has to be put to sleep by midnight, and chained up when he gets his gold medal, which I find absolutely hilarious and fitting. Bakugo is so filled with rage that he's even able to intimidate All Might. Ida wasn't able to attend the ceremony, however, as he had to leave as soon as possible to check on his older brother. Ida arrives and his brother is still alive, but is in critical condition. After the sports festival is done, Todoroki decides to go visit his mom in the hospital to try to repair their relationship. Uraraka arrives home to her parents congratulating her on her performance during the festival, and the arc ends in the most fitting way, with Bakugo mad at something.
Don't worry, it's just a phase, you'll grow out of it.
I still firmly believe that the sports festival arc in My Hero is the best arc in this show so far. Everything just looked like it was firing on all cylinders, from character introductions of Shinso and students from the other courses, to character developments and highlights like Midoriya, Bakugo, Ida, Todoroki, and Tokuyami. Character interactions in this arc were also incredible, as most of the people that did interact with each other actually had reason behind them, and none of the interactions were pointless by any means. Much like the first season, the music was always on point, and the fight sequences only seemed to escalate from the first season. Not only because of an increase in budget, but also in terms of choreography. I will say, however, that the fight sequences in the first season out-edged the sports festival arc in terms of drawing suspense, though. That's because there was usually something at stake in the first season. Overall, the sports festival arc is easily rewatchable, fires everything off with quick pacing, and provides a great viewing experience. Anyways, now it's time for me to give this arc a rating. As you know, every time I cover something, I'll be giving it a score out of 100, and I give the My Hero Academia sports festival arc a 91 out of 100. Outstanding and another must watch. And with that, we move on to the second half of season 2, aka the Stain arc. Hey, thank you so much for watching this video all the way through. I hope you enjoyed me covering the sports festival arc of My Hero Academia. I'll be covering the Stain arc in the next anime review video, and try to keep posting these videos consistently. Also, if you like what I do here, consider subscribing. It's always free and you can change your mind later. And be sure to hit the bell icon so that way you always get a notification whenever I post the next anime review video. And again, I just wanted to thank everyone for all the support on the first video. It means a lot and it lets me know that you want to see more of this type of content. Link will be in the description to check out the first video if you haven't already. Anyways, with that being said, thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Take it easy!